The sights and sounds of a well-attended dawn parade in Wellington there. And being Anzac Day, it's a fitting time to talk to our Minister of Defence. Peeni Henare is at Whakatane's RSA this morning. Kia ora, Minister. Can you just tell me what's going on there right now?
Thank you for having me. We've just had our dawn service, so there's a little bit of a break before we head towards the civic service at 10 a.m. It was well attended this morning, just from where I was seated, hundreds of people, and so now we look towards the civic service and then of course sharing some time with our returned service people this afternoon.
And what's the significance of the medals as well?
So these medals belong to my grandfather, who was the final commander of the 28th Māori Battalion, and I wear them with pride and honour today.
I want to talk to you about your role as Defence Minister. You have been criticised by Newsroom for being AWOL in your role as Defence, and it's fair to say you've been pretty quiet in this area. Is Defence just not as much of a priority under this government as it was under New Zealand First?
No, this is a priority portfolio for us, and I'm honoured to be the Minister of Defence. We do have a number of challenges and projects in front of us that are important, and I say that because not since, I think it's my former colleague, the Honourable Phil Goff, has Labour had a Minister of Defence. So now that we're government, we've been working quite hard actually to work on our policy and strategic
platforms.
Well, I mean, you know, the work's got to be done in the engine room, and that's where we're focused on at the moment, to make sure that our policy and our strategic direction align with this government's.
I mean, when you think about under New Zealand First, though, they got our troops combat ready, they pumped in a lot of money, Orion's, for example. So what are you doing in this space? Will you be moving back from that? Do you think we need to be combat ready?
We must always be combat ready, and it's come quite clear to me as I've gone around with the different services, there are a number of challenges. Obviously, our Defence Force are currently engaged in Op Protect, which is keeping our borders safe. However, we know that in order for us to be able to respond, we've got to be at a certain operability, if you like, and readiness, and that is proving difficult and a challenge under Op Protect, but the services assure me that our focus right now is the borders, and we'll continue to be as ready as we can be.
Why do we need to be combat ready?
Well, it's important. So it isn't just combat in the traditional sense. The services, of course, do a lot of work, humanitarian. They've been in the Pacific recently, supporting with a number of disasters up in the Pacific. And it is important that we remain ready at any point in time, and that's across all of the services. So that's why we must make sure that we're able to maintain a core group who are able and ready to serve when on notice.
You talked about having challenges to that. Are we ready to go into combat if we were called upon? Are we poised and ready to go?
My belief is we are. I have talked about the challenges of Op Protect, where a large number of our service personnel are at the moment. But in my time with the service chiefs, they have told me that they are ready. However, I must acknowledge that it isn't quite as clear-cut as making a call and we're off to any theatre, wherever that might be.
In terms of where we're going with that, I mean, next month, we're pulling out of Afghanistan completely. Is this the end of us following our big partners into combat?
No, I don't think it is. We continue to train with them. We continue to have quite close relationships with them as a defence force. So I'm going to say no. It isn't an end to a traditional kind of alliance, but certainly as we look towards the future, and I know Minister Mahuta and the Prime Minister, as we look towards the geopolitical space, my key role is to make sure that the Defence Force is ready.
So if Joe Biden, for example, called on you for military support, what would you say?
Look, I've been in touch with Secretary Austin, the Secretary of Defence from the United States, and we've had quite a good conversation about making sure we're able to support each other in a number of fields. Of course, we look towards the Pacific in recent conversations with them. Of course, we stand ready to support.
Will the Defence Force get more money in next month's budget?
Well, this is one of the challenges that you didn't touch on with respect to New Zealand First. We've faced a pandemic, and over the past year, COVID has been the key driver for this government, and our job is to respond to that responsibly. So as we look towards the budget, you'll have to wait for budget day.
Oh, I just thought you might sneak that one in for me. I wanted to ask you a question that crosses over between both of your portfolios. What happens if any Defence Force personnel refuse to take the vaccine?
That's a good question. So just like it is for our frontline border workers, we need to make sure that, one, we offer the right information in order for them to make an informed decision. A large number and a huge percentage of the Defence Force have already accepted the vaccine. In fact, quite a large number have already received the second part of the vaccine. For those who have decided not to...
What's the latest on that? Do you have those numbers?
If I recall correctly, the numbers recently is close to 9,000, so about 8,500 of our uniformed personnel have been vaccinated. Just over half of those have received their second vaccination now. But for those who choose not to, of course, they'll continue to work with the Defence Force as we look to where they might continue to play a role.
Have you done any work around how many people have refused so far and what's happening to them? Are they going to back office jobs or how's that going to work?
In a recent visit to the Linton Army camp, we've spoken to a large number of those who've already received. It's been identified to me that there are a number, if I recall correctly, of just over 100 or so who have chosen not to. We're going to continue to engage with them. I've offered, as I have done in Māori communities around the country, to actually sit down and talk them through and answer their questions that they might have in the hope that they will receive the vaccine. If they choose not to, then the Defence Force will continue to work with them to see how they might play a role in the Defence Force, broadly speaking.
So how would that work? They're just that group of 100, for example, if they still continue to refuse, they would just have to do jobs that didn't involve in any way the MIQ, or could they no longer be in the Defence Force?
Well, they necessarily wouldn't play a role in the MIQ and Op Protect at the moment, because that's the front line and that's where we need our people to have the best protection to continue with that particular deployment and Op Protect. Whether or not they continue to serve in the Defence Force, that's not a decision for me. But like I've said, the Defence Force will continue to work with them to see where they might have a role in the future.
The Māori Health Authority, earlier in the show I had Andrew Little, the Health Minister, on here. As Associate Minister, I want to get your opinion on this as well. How will you make sure that that Māori Health Authority has the power and has the funding it needs to make a difference to these very poor statistics when it comes to Māori?
The first one is to make sure we have the legislation in place to allow, as we've said and Minister Little has agreed, that we allow Māori to actually design the space for themselves. What they made clear to us was they wanted authority, an independent authority. An independent authority isn't one that's prescribed by the government. So we've got to give them that space.
Doesn't that create two separate systems, though, when you talk about independent?
Well, we've made it clear that the Māori Health Authority had to be independent. That was what the Waitangi Tribunal finding was, and we'll continue to support that ambition. But what we've also made clear is that that independent authority must continue to have levers and influence across the entire health sector. And with respect to your first question about resources, of course, it's all eyes on the budget, but I've made it clear to my colleagues that if we do want to turn the dial on poor Māori health statistics, we must invest there.
So more oomph than whānau ora?
Yes, well, as Minister for Whānau Ora as well, whānau ora's done well, but when we look towards the health statistics, and they're quite clear, it is going to require significant resource.
Well, Minister, thank you very much for your time today. We'll let you get back to the RSA. Thank you for being with us.